No.
I need the other hour.
I need the other hour. It's close. Good morning. How's everybody today? Good.
Now, there we are. I'm on now. You can tell. Well, it's good to see you. And if you didn't hear what I said already, welcome. We had a beautiful night on Friday night with our worship team that was here. And there are CDs out in the back. The Jim has recorded the CD. And we're going to do one of those songs off the CD this morning. It's not on the CD. That's right. But it's one of the songs that's going to be on his next CD. But it's a beautiful song, Christus Victor. And we introduced it a little bit last week, I think. We're going to do that this week. But a couple of things. Good news is that we have all of our Magi and our King Herod lined up for the live nativity. So that is great. And that said, if you are involved in the live nativity, we're having a dress rehearsal next Saturday at 3 p.m. So Word of Life students will be down here, and we're also going to have a costume fitting. So if you are in any part of the live nativity that requires a fitting, a costume, please be here next week. And then please see Darcy. The sign-up sheet is out there for the cookies to prepare for that. So that's going to be an important, it's a big part of it. We have been blessed. We are going to be having the tents like we did last year for the community holiday parade, and All Town Fresh has offered to participate with us, and so they're going to be providing muffins, bagels, hot chocolate, and sandwiches at no cost. So that's marvelous, yeah. So they're going to be out there. We just have to brew the coffee and have some cookies and stuff, but they want to be part of what we're part of, and it's marvelous of how we're connecting people to the community, to the church, and the church is being connected to the community. So that's really a prayer of praise. And then Darcy has an announcement about the Operation Christmas Child.
Morning. We're packing shoeboxes this Friday at 6 p.m. downstairs. If you still want to donate, this week is the last week to donate anything, whether it be financially or items that you want to bring in. So please come and help us pack the shoeboxes this Friday at 6. Thanks.
Okay. And if there isn't anything else, Jim, would you open us in prayer?
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this place that you've provided with all the resources that come with it, Lord. Help us to be creative. Give us your ideas about what we need to be able to reach the world with this building. Lord, we ask that you would anoint us today, that we would be able to receive what you have for us. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand.
I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee. holy desire. This place in time, that I might seek and find my God. Lord, I want to yearn for you. I want to burn with passion over you and only you. Lord, I want to yearn for you. I want to burn. Yet why am I with all my singing and bringing praise in light of Him? Lord, I want to yearn for you. I want to burn with passion over you and only you, Lord. I want to burn with passion over you and only you. Oh, you give life and breath. In you we live and move. That's why I say, Lord, I want to yearn for you. I want to burn.
Ethan and Andy to come on up. If you weren't here last week, this is a brand new song. We did it as special music, so I'm going to do it again next week so that we really get to learn it.
The Most High King of the ages, great I am, God of all. Our strength, our song, our sure salvation. Now to the Lamb upon the throne be blessing, honor, glory, power for the battle you have won. Alleluia, amen. Oh,
be seated. Well, there are some people who are happy today, and there are some people who are not so happy today, perhaps, over the election Tuesday. But if you are in Christ, you have the joy of the Lord. The politicians aren't going to change anything. Surprise. In fact, this is a dangerous time, I think, for us. Because so many have put their faith in our elected officials that we fail to realize that whoever sits, wherever they sit, the Lord who sits on the throne is the one who raises up leaders, and he takes leaders down. He raises up nations, and he takes nations down. He is in control of everything. He is the sovereign, almighty God. And so to him we come, and to him we put our trust in. As the psalmist writes, some people will trust in their chariots and in their horses, but we will trust in the name of the Lord our God. This is a time where God has given perhaps the church an opportunity to get back on her feet and to do what she's called to do, to go and to bring the good news to all peoples of every nation, of every kindred, of every tribe, of every tongue, all people groups, to really be that Great Commission church whereby we are really a life-giving church and that we are connecting people to the life-transforming power of Jesus Christ, to his glory, and to go out and to make disciples of all peoples and to baptize them in the name of the triune God, to teach them all things whatsoever Jesus has commanded, and thank you that he is with us to the end of the age. But in times like these where everybody is applauding perhaps the outcomes, we can get complacent. But God perhaps is giving us a window of opportunity, a window to test us, to see will we be, what we will do in such times. So the time is now for ours to go out and to faithfully, by the power of the Holy Spirit, win those to Christ for his glory. Would you bow with me in prayer this morning? O Most High King of the ages, Christus Victor, Christ Victorious, we praise your name this morning, Lord. And I pray we have come already celebrating your worthiness, your majesty, your splendor, your power, your love, your mercy, and your grace, your righteousness. I pray we come celebrating our salvation, the forgiveness of our sins through the shedding of your blood, Lord Jesus, on the cross. I pray we've already come victorious in knowing that the grave could not hold you, and that, Lord, death could not keep you. And because all of those who are yours, the grave cannot keep us, we are risen with Christ. We praise you this morning, Lord. We praise you, Father, for how you blessed our evening Friday night. We praise you for the joy that was in this place. We praise you, Lord, that even hearts were broken. And perhaps there was a renewal, Lord, a renewal of commitment to you, a renewal in how we are to conduct our lives if we are yours. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Father, for this glorious day that you've given to us, another day to come and to celebrate you. And Father, this morning I think of our veterans as we remember Veterans Day. For each one here today, Lord, for those who have served, we thank you, Father. And we thank them for their service to this great nation, one nation under God. For those, Lord, who have paid the ultimate sacrifice with their own lives. And Lord, even for those who have come back from the battlefields, forever changed, Lord, we lift them up to you before the throne of grace today to be merciful to them. And I pray we'll take time to honor and thank our veterans for the freedoms that we have in this nation, that we can fly our flag, Lord. But I pray above all that we would go to you, the one who has truly given us freedom, the one who has won the battles for us, the one who has given to the soldiers courage on the battlefield and stamina to overcome when they think they could not. You, O God, are the victor in all battles. And we await that glorious day until you come again, once and for all, and all things shall be defeated, and you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. Oh, how we praise you this morning, Lord Jesus Christ. We lift up to you our sister Bev this morning and ask your blessing upon her, Father, and your will to be done. We think of our sister in Christ, Millie, Lord, and we pray, Father. We pray, Lord, though it is a hard prayer to pray, we pray, Father, you be merciful and bring her home into glory. Lord, she has served you well, and Lord, we ask for continued strength for her family as they minister to her, Lord, in these days and in these hours, Lord. But Lord, your will be done in all these things. Lord, at the proclamation of your word today, how I pray, Father, that as your word goes forth, Father, the proclaimer of your word would first be the recipient of it and be changed. So Lord, you speak to me. Fill me with your spirit, O God, to proclaim your word. And fill this beautiful body of believers with your spirit to receive your word. And where change needs to take place, Lord, change us unto your glory. And now, Father, as we continue to praise you in song, lift our hearts and our voices to you in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the hardest things to do is to be still. But the scripture says, be still and know that I am God. Even in the most difficult times, be still and know that he is God. Thank you. Well, if you have your copy of God's Word, would you open it with me to Luke chapter 1, beginning in verse 8. And I'm going to stand with you, ask you to stand with me to honor God at the reading of His Word. If you're able, please stand. Luke chapter 1, verses 8 through 18. When his division was on duty, he was serving as priest before God. It happened that he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to enter the sanctuary of the Lord and burn incense. At the hour of incense, the whole assembly of the people was praying outside. Isn't that awesome? An angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was terrified and overcome with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah, because your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you will name him John. There will be joy and delight for you, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He will never drink wine or beer. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit while still in his mother's womb. He will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. And he will go before him in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the disobedient to the understanding of the righteous to make ready for the Lord a prepared people." "How can I know this?" Zechariah asked the angel. "For I am an old man and my wife well along in years." Amen. You may be seated. I love that. Zechariah says, "I'm an old man," but he dared not call his wife an old lady. He was a wise man, that's for sure. She must have been close outside. I don't know. You know, it was a blessing on Friday to come here and to worship. And as we were practicing a little bit before and getting things in order, there was a woman who was here, who was a good friend of Jim for something like 47 years at least. And as we were practicing, I noticed something about Jim. And she noticed the same thing. You come up here, you never, there's not a nervous bone in his body. Right? He's coming to worship. But Friday night, I'm thinking, why is he not like singing out? And she came up and she said to him, "Hey, what's this? Just play in the Spirit. Worship him in the Spirit." Friday night was not anything that Jim could have ever imagined. He wouldn't contrive this, but the Lord had planned this all along, the CD, all of these things that were going on. And there's so much to deal with about worship, being faithful to the call that God has put on our lives. And in whatever he has given us to do, the first thing that we must do is to worship him. I cannot lead you to worship. If you've come here thinking that I'm going to lead you to worship, in fact, we read in some places that the pastor is the worship leader. Other times it is the person who's got the music responsibility, right? The praise songs. But Jim cannot lead us to worship. Doesn't happen. He has no really power to do that. I have no power. The Word of God tells us that we must come already worshiping Him. And over the years, we have really begun to conflate worship with other types of meanings. To think that we can go to church, and before we get to this building, everything is horrible. But when we come in here, we are just going to feel enlightened just by walking in, and the pastor's going to do it, or the worship leader, the music minister is going to do that. And all of a sudden, we're going to be transformed in a moment, some unique way. But what does worship, what is the definition of worship? I looked into this quite a bit. And it's interesting to see the Hebrew and the Greek, and I will not trouble you with all of those words. But suffice to say, the summation of worship is this. Worship is the dramatic celebration of God in His supreme worth in such a manner that His worthiness becomes the norm and inspiration of human living. Let me say that again. Worship is the dramatic celebration of God. We're already coming to celebrate Almighty God. We are already celebrating Him. We are singing, right, as Paul wrote to the Ephesian church, to greet one another with a psalm or a hymn or a spiritual song, but make a melody in your heart. That is a celebration of God. Greet each other this way. So we come already celebrating Almighty God, and we celebrate Him in His worth, His supreme worth. How valuable, let me ask you, how valuable is your salvation to you? How valuable is Almighty God to you? How valuable is the sacrifice of Christ on the cross to you and the shedding of His blood? How valuable is the resurrection of Jesus Christ? How valuable is the righteousness of God imputed to you? How valuable is the incarnation of God with us? Christmas, how valuable is Christmas? Emmanuel, God coming in the flesh, Almighty God in the flesh, the incarnation, how valuable is Christmas to you? Do we have a season of thanksgiving where we celebrate God and His worth in such a manner that His very worthiness becomes the norm and the inspiration of how we live our lives? That is worship. And I cannot create that in you. Jim cannot create that in you. Because worship places God at the center of His worthiness. Worship avoids the tyranny of subjectivism, which is people's thoughts, my own thoughts, and I just rest in my thoughts. But the Bible says, take none of your thoughts, right, captive, but take all thoughts captive to Christ. For His ways are higher than our ways, and His thoughts so much higher than ours. Worship puts God at the center and allows for the reexamination of ourself in the light of God's knowledge of us. When you look historically from Israel's worship, it was always a response to Yahweh. It was always a response to God and His acts toward them. It's what He performed in Israel's history, the whole history. And their story is a life of coexistence with Almighty God. It was this partnership that lived out in this historical drama that we read of in the Old Testament. And the emphasis is always on God as being the initiator. God is the one who initiates worship in your hearts and in my heart. God is the one who initiates all things that will bring honor and glory to him. We don't initiate anything. He is the initiator. This is what was going on in Israel's life. And Israel responds. They addressed Almighty God in a very personal way. And they'd offer praise to him. And in their offering of praise, they began to ask questions of God. That's part of worship. As we're praising him, now God causes us to ask questions of him. We're still tied up in worship. And yes, even in worship, we can have times of complaining. David had times of complaining. Read the Psalms. But he still acknowledged God as his refuge, God as his deliverer, God as his protector. When he thought, how long, O God? How long, O God, is this going to last? In the end, he praises God. This is all part of worship. And sometimes when we are praising God and our problems come in because God is showing us what the real problem is, it's us. He begins to initiate in our lives, and all of a sudden we begin to cry out. We suddenly think, oh God, why am I saying this? Why should I be complaining? Why should I be telling you of my problem? No, God says, you're worshiping me. I'm at the center of your praise. I'm at the center of your problems. I am at the center of your life. You come to me. This was Israel. This was their binding history together in celebration of their relationship with their Creator God. And in the New Testament, now we see the church, and the emphasis is falling on the historical facts, if you will, of the triune God. And with the central focus now to the church of being the incarnation of God, the cross, and then the burial, and yes, the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave. And there we have the exaltation of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, God's Son, made real. How and by whom? By me? Nope. By Jim? Nope. By any one of us? No. But by the Holy Spirit of God, who lives and dwells within each and every one of us. And so, no matter what we do, no matter where we do it, God calls us to worship him and to be faithful to the call that he has put on our lives. The call is to worship him. That's the call. People say, I've been called to do this. I've been called. That's the big thing now, right? I've been called to leave the church. Show me that. I've been called. You've been called. We've been called to worship God. That's his call upon our life. Let me say it again. To celebrate him and his supreme worth in such a manner that his worthiness becomes the norm and inspiration of our lives. No matter where we are, no matter what we do, God is at the center of it because of his worthiness. And we see our unworthiness compared to his. And we fall down before him and we worship him. So no matter where we're going, no matter what life throws at us, we are worshiping him because he is worthy and we are in such need. Zechariah was a man faithful to the call of Almighty God. The Bible tells us that he had been chosen and ordained by God to be a priest. Who chose Zechariah to be a priest? God did. Zechariah had nothing to do with it. That was his, quote unquote, pun intended, lot in life. He was chosen to be a priest by Almighty God. And he accepted that call of God that was given to him. And he was faithful to Almighty God despite the problems that he faced in his life, and certainly he and his wife Elizabeth. You remember that when we opened up the scripture and this beautiful biblical truth, this beautiful biblical story of Zechariah and Elizabeth, that Elizabeth, they were called blameless, but they were what? Without child. She could not conceive. And if you remember that I said that if you were a Jewish woman back then and you could not bear a child, especially bear a son, there was something wrong between you and God. That for some reason they believe God did not find favor upon them. And now we have Zechariah, who is a priest, and we have Elizabeth, who is a godly woman, both of them with a beautiful lineage of righteous people. And all of a sudden now, something hits them in their lives, and whoa! Isn't that amazing? I was talking a little bit about this with a wonderful couple, dear friends. Just how sometimes we don't think that because we're living the most godly life that we're going to get hit with something. Well, that's not true. You can live the most righteous and godly life, and life will come your way. Sometimes it's a test from God. Sometimes it's the tempter, Satan, coming in your life because he wants to take you down. But the question is, will we worship God and be faithful to his call in spite of our problems, in spite of our circumstances, no matter what comes our way? Will we worship him and be faithful to the call that he has put upon our lives? Zechariah is childless, but he's a priest, and he is steadfast in his duties. Now, of all the blessings that he had from God, the one that he desired most, he doesn't have. He doesn't have a son. He doesn't have this child that he and his wife had been praying for. And so all of his life, and he, by his own statement, he says, I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years. So for whatever reason, God is not approving of me. And all of a sudden, on a day that he did not expect, at a time that he did not expect, and at a place, God changed all things around. He says, no, Zechariah, I'm going to show you how I do approve of you. You're going to be chosen today to do the greatest thing that a priest could ever be done, could ever do in that priest's vocation. I'm calling you, I'm choosing you to enter into the sanctuary to offer incense up to me on behalf of all of the people. This is the highest honor that a priest back then could ever be given, would be to offer up incense. Wow. Today we can get incense wherever, right? You can even sing songs about incense and peppermints or whatever if you're old enough to remember that one, right? When I was a young Catholic kid growing up, I lived right next door to the church. I got the funerals, which was really good because I got out of school. So my cousin Louie and I, we got the funerals. He lived downstairs and I lived upstairs. So as a young Catholic boy, as an altar boy, I got to play with matches, light the candles, and light the charcoal for the incense, and then put the incense on. I'll never forget, we had one particular funeral, and there was a priest there. His name was Al Monte. And because the Bible says you shall call no one father, I don't call anybody father, you know, right? Only because you have a father in heaven. He's not talking about dads. He's talking about we don't call anybody father, right? And so his name was Pastor Al Monte. He was a wonderful man. He really was. He was a chaplain. It's veterans remembering our vets. He was a chaplain in World War II in the Pacific. He was also a prisoner of war in the Japanese prison camp, and they were not merciful to him because he was a chaplain. They tortured him in all ways. So much so that, sadly, Pastor Al, later on in life, and we knew this of him, that he was an alcoholic. But he also knew every pressure point in the body. 2 years in a Japanese prison camp, he learned very quickly where all the pressure points were. So he said to me and my cousin Louis, just a little bit of incense, boys, just a little incense. We smoked that place out. You couldn't see the congregation from the altar, I'm telling you. Where's the casket? Nobody knew. But my cousin Louis and I thought it was pretty cool, and we were laughing our heads off. This is a funeral, and we're giggling away up there. After the service, however, good old Pastor Al said, thank you very much, boys. Well, my cousin Louis's down from a pressure point in his hand somewhere, and I've got a knuckle in the mandible. And I'm, wow, 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 wow. And he pretty much told us if we ever did that again, it would be much worse for us. But it was fun being a Catholic. It was great, all these incense stuff. But Zechariah has the greatest day of his life. The Bible says that the lot fell to him, and he was one of the chosen priests to offer this incense. His division had been called up. Now, there are thousands and thousands of people there. They had to put these priests in divisions. So you have thousands of people. You've got divisions of priests. And out of all of these divisions of priests, Zechariah just happens to be the one that God calls up on this particular day, at this particular time, for this particular purpose. Did you ever think that sometimes when you're going through the worst problems in your life, that on a particular day, at a particular place, and a particular time, when you least expect him, God will show up and say, I have chosen you this day for this purpose. There is Zechariah. And now he is in, and make no mistakes about it, unlike me as a sinning youth with the incense, when Zechariah went into the sanctuary, he was laser focused on Almighty God. He did not take his call lightly. He was a righteous man, blameless in the sight of God. And he goes in there, and he is in this focused worship. And as he is celebrating God and the worthiness of God and doing his duties, all of a sudden, the angel appears to him. This is the angel Gabriel. Gabriel is one who is called to bring the messages of God. And Gabriel showed up in many places in the scripture. Gabriel showed up, and he spoke to Daniel. Gabriel has shown up to Zechariah. Gabriel is going to show up in just a little while to a virgin by the name of Mary. But angels are not as people would think that they are. They are not fluffy, feather-bearing, overweight midgets with an arrow in the heart. They're not these Cupids that we portray. These are magnificent, majestic beings that if you were to see an angel, fear would strike your heart. You would fall down. In fact, we read in Revelation that when John fell down at the angel's feet, the angel says, no, you get up. You do not worship me. You do not celebrate me. Get up. But when angels appear, these are majestic, glorious beings. These are powerful beings. And they strike fear even into the hearts of the righteous. They're so awesome in power that some people have actually believed in the scripture that this is God himself. And others like Zechariah, fear strikes their heart. But they're messengers of God. They come with a message. And we see that in Scripture, Peter, he is chained in prison. James had been executed just the day before by the sword. And the people were all excited. Can you imagine that? Jerusalem's all excited. Somebody was was martyred. And now Herod orders that Peter be arrested. And he's going to be executed. He's in his jail cell. He's chained up between four legions of guards. There's 16. There's divisions. Four by four. 16. And they're chained to a fisherman. What power does he have? And Peter goes to sleep. He's going to be executed in the morning. But he's sleeping. And all of a sudden, an angel of the Lord says, "Yo, get up." Peter's like, "Five more minutes." "No, get up now." And the chains fall off, the doors open, and Peter walks out. He says, "I thought it was a dream. I thought I was dreaming. But all of a sudden I realized." And then he realizes he's out of prison, and he heads off. And guess where he heads? He heads off to a woman's house, name of Rhoda. And there the church is gathered together in her house. And there are people, what are they praying for? Well, they're praying for Peter. I don't know what they were praying, but they're praying for Peter. I'm guessing maybe they were praying that God would release Peter somehow. And all of a sudden, there's a knock at the door, and a girl goes to answer the door. And as Peter says, "Hey, how's it going? I'm out." She runs back in, and she says, "Peter's at the door." And they said, "You've lost your mind. It's impossible. Right, he's going to be executed." She said, "I'm telling you." The next thing, like, the soldiers are still coming. And now all of a sudden, what happens? The angel had come to him. And now they're celebrating in the house. Peter's been released. They're worshiping God. Do you think that they were worshiping God before Peter's release? I do. I think their focus was all on God, because nobody could get him out of this. It was impossible. Peter and James are now, they are locked up, and they're getting beaten in prison because they're preaching and teaching in the name of Jesus. And so they call them before the leaders, they beat them again, and they say, "Listen, we're letting you go, but if you ever teach and preach in the name of this Jesus again, it's going to be far worse for you." And they leave, and where do they go? They go to a house. What are the people, what's the church doing in the house? They're praying. And in their prayers, they're worshiping. Because, and I'm so glad you had that question. You cannot pray without worshiping. It's impossible. God is the center of our prayers. He is the one to be praised in our prayers. So you can't pray without worshiping God. They're worshiping God and they're praying. And Peter and John get there and they tell them what happened. And the church begins to cry out to God together with them, praising God, the creator of all things. And they're using the scriptures that they know. And all of a sudden, they say, "Here's my prayer request. These people told us we cannot go out and preach and teach in the name of Jesus. God, give us boldness to go preach and teach in the name of Christ." And the place where they were praying, the Bible says, in that house, the Spirit of the living God shook that house. And what did those people do? They all went out and they preached and they taught in the name of Jesus with all boldness. They did exactly what God called them to do. They worshiped him and they were faithful to the call that God put on their lives in spite of the problems that they were having and in spite of the problems that could come about based upon the call of God in their lives. The question for us is, will we worship God and honor the call of God on our lives in spite of what we're going through now and in spite of what might befall us tomorrow? This was what Zechariah was doing. He was faithful to God's call, and he was worshiping him. And so the angel comes in, and it is tremendous to see what happens there. He's inside the temple worshiping. He's burning incense upon the altar before the morning and evening sacrifice. It symbolizes the worship and the prayers going up, the incense. And in the midst of all of that, focused on God, to the right of the altar of incense, there stands Gabriel. There's this angel. He's going to give him seven statements that are applicable for us today. The first one is this. Do not be afraid. Verse 13. In verse 12, when Zechariah saw him, the angel, he says he was terrified and overcome with fear. The angel struck fear into the heart of him. He's a righteous man. Who do you expect to be there in the temple, in the sanctuary, right? But it's an angel. And immediately, the angel says, do not be afraid. It's something that in the scripture, when you look at the disciples who are in the boat, Jesus is sleeping in the boat. Lord, get up. We got a storm here. Wake up. Don't you care that we're going to die? Jesus tells him, don't be afraid. Gets up, says to the wind and the waves, shh, quiet, be still. Oh. And all of creation is still because they know that he is God. Another time, they're in the boat again. They look out and they see Jesus coming, but they think it's a ghost. He's coming fast. And Peter said, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come to you. But before that, Jesus said, be not afraid. Love that song Sailor sings. Be not afraid, the Lord is on, right? Your side. Be not afraid, the Lord is on your side. We know the rest of that story. Don't be afraid. And Joshua is called to lead the people over into the promised land. God comes to Joshua and speaks to him and says, do not fear. Only be strong and courageous. Again, Joshua, do not be afraid, but be strong and courageous. So the angel comes and he says, do not be afraid. God alone is our comfort. And he comes to us in places, in times, in situations where we have no idea when he's going to come, but he shows up and he is the God of all comfort. And he says, do not be afraid. I am on your side. The angel was on the right side of the altar of incense, symbolizing God was on Zechariah's side. God is on your side. Are you in Christ? God is on your side. And then he goes on to say something else. Verse 13. Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Which prayer? Let me ask you, what prayer do you want God to hear? I mean, what is the big one in your life that you want God to hear? Now, I don't know how this worked out. Zechariah is an old man. His wife is old, well along in years. They can't have kids anymore. That ship has sailed. Do you think that Zechariah stopped praying for a son? I don't know. Maybe he did. And he just said, you know what? Thy will be done. That's what's going to happen. That's going to happen. Okay. Or maybe he did. Maybe somewhere, because the angel didn't say Zechariah and Elizabeth's prayer. It says, Zechariah, your prayer has been heard. Maybe Zechariah said, you know, even though Jesus hadn't spoken yet, he believed that, yeah, with me, it's impossible, but with God, all things are possible. I don't know, but either way, I know this. God heard his prayer. And I know this about Almighty God. You might have had a prayer that you think so much time has passed that you've put it away. But God hasn't put it away. God hasn't put that prayer request away. It's still at the forefront of his mind. his prayer. Your wife, he says, will bear you a son, and you will name him John. It's amazing. You know, perhaps verse 18 gives us a little bit of insight that maybe Zechariah was not praying for a son based on his response, which was not good for him. But anyway, we're going to talk about that next week. But maybe Zechariah had thought that God had not heard this particular prayer. He didn't realize something, and maybe you don't realize something. God records every prayer. And he has no memory problem. You might have put it away, but God has never put it away. And on a particular day, in a particular time, in a particular location, God will astonish you with the answer to prayer. In the fullness of time, God sent this angel. And this is what God was saying through the angel. Zechariah, I heard you. Hey, if you don't think that God hears you, you're sorely mistaken. God hears you. He says, I heard you, and I have you in mind. I have stored up your prayers, and one in particular, for this moment in time in salvation. I'm interested in your prayers, Zechariah, and your prayers delight me. What you do here today with the incense, you delight me in your regular life. Whether you burn incense in the sanctuary, or whether you and your wife are in fellowship, or you by yourself are in worship and fellowship with me, I am delighted in you because you worship me and you follow my call in spite of what's going on in your life. I am delighted in you and I hear your prayers, Zechariah. So delighted was God. This was awesome. Is that God says, not only am I going to give you and your wife the son you've been praying for, I've already picked out a name for you. Isn't that awesome? I don't have to worry about it. Whoa, what to give? What name to give today? No, I've got a name for you. It's all right. It's good. And then he says in verse 3, or verse 14, the third thing he says, there's going to be joy and delight for you. And he says, many will rejoice at his birth. Wow, at John the Baptist being born, many will rejoice at his birth, and he's going to be a joy and delight for you. If we were to stop right there and go no further, every one of us most likely would be satisfied with what God said to the angel for us. Why? What are the three things that most people would love to be freed up of? Fear. Take fear away. Do not be afraid, right? Most people want a family. Give me a family. And give me joy and happiness. Those are the three things that most people would desire. Freedom of fear, a family, joy and happiness. That's what they would want. We settle for small prizes, don't we? But the angel went on. And so shall I for just a few more minutes. Just a few more minutes. He says, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. Verse number 15. God is going to have a special regard for this child. He will be a mighty man of God. You say, well, that was John the Baptist. Let me tell you something. God has regard for every human life. Every human life. He has regard for every child in the womb. No child is a mistake. None. It may not have occurred the way we would think it would have occurred. But No child is a mistake from God. My Bible tells me that at a point in time in Jeremiah's life when he was a young man, he said, Jeremiah, let me tell you something. Before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you, and I set you apart for a particular purpose for me. My Bible tells me that God has fearfully and wonderfully made us. My Bible tells me that God is the very one who knitted us in our mother's womb. My Bible tells me that he knows every hair on my head. He knows me intimately, and he knew me and he knew you before he formed us in the womb of our mothers. God regards every child, the unborn to the very aged, to those that some have said they are deformed, but in God's eyes, he has created them for his glory. The word of God says, did not I create the blind and the deaf and the dumb? When they asked Jesus, was this man born blind because his parents sinned? He says, absolutely not. He was born to give me glory. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit while still in his mother's womb. We went to a beautiful dinner for Next Step For You Pregnancy Center. Several of us went to that. And there was a keynote speaker who said some things, and I can't tell you what the German name was, but I do know what the English meaning is, what he said. These words were spoken by a man. Lives not worthy of life. Lives not worthy of life. And this evil man looked at a population of people, and he said to the Jews, you have lives not worthy of life. His name was Adolf Hitler. And then he looked to Europe. He looked to his own people. You're not like you should be. You're not the perfect race. You are lives not worthy of life. And over 9 million people were exterminated because a man got a group of people to believe lives are not worthy of life. And Margaret Sanger got a group of people in a nation that's supposed to be one nation under God to believe that the life within a mother's womb is not worthy of living, is not worthy of life. I was astounded at the number. The number of babies that have been aborted to date would wipe out the entire continent of Africa. The entire continent of Africa. Billions. For people of color, that was the plan. And today, Planned Parenthoods are established in underserved, lower socioeconomic income places of living that are positioned within the reach of the college campuses. Lives not worth. But every child is a creation of God. John, from conception, would be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. And so we have this reference to alcoholic beverages here. You will not drink wine or beer, not to be under the influence of those. In Ephesians 5:18, do not get drunk with wine, but be filled by the Spirit. John was anointed with the Spirit of God, not with the spirits of men. And then he says in verse 16, the sixth statement, he will turn many of the children of Israel to the Lord their God. God is going to use Zechariah to ignite a revival in Israel. This is tremendous. And then he, John, now we get into verse 17, will go before him, the Lord, in the spirit and power of Elijah, to do what? To turn the hearts of fathers to the children and the disobedient to the understanding of the righteous, to make ready for the Lord a prepared people. The angel of the Lord did not just show up on this particular day, at this particular place, at this particular time, with no purpose in mind. God always has a purpose, and he always has a plan. It's in accordance with his plan of redemption. So here's what I close out with. He's speaking to Zechariah. It was a historic, unique moment in the time of the history of salvation. Why? Because not since the last words were spoken in the Old Testament, Malachi was speaking, or God was speaking to Malachi, the last prophet. It was over 400 years prior to the coming of the angel to Zechariah in the temple. God ever give you the silent treatment? God's not talking to you? Why is not God speaking to you? He's going to show up. He's got a plan, and he's got a purpose. And God comes in, and he comes and he breaks the silence. And to all of you, whether you're a man or whether you're a woman, if you were consider yourself an old man or an old woman today, God is not through with you. He spoke to an old man. He's never done with you until he calls you home. He speaks to the old and to the aged today. And he breaks the silence. And what does he say? What is he speaking? He picks up where he left off with the last words spoken 400 years prior in Malachi chapter 4, verses 5 and 6. He made promises in the Old Testament that he begins now to fulfill in the New Testament. He sends John as another Elijah who will prepare the way for the coming of the Messiah for the people, the nation of Israel. And now he sends his long-awaited Savior to his people. Zacharias is praying while he offers incense up to God. He's worshiping. He led the people not to worship, but he led them to pray. My dear friends, God will do nothing without a praying people. The church is to pray. But without worshiping God first, our prayers fall flat. So if you want your prayers to rise up, come and worship him in all of who he is, the character of God. And follow your call according to what he's put on your life. All of the people were praying. They were to be involved in the prayer and in the worship of God as he was. You are to be, in fact, Dan Henderson said it this way, and I love what he said. The level of prayer in the church will only rise to the level of the prayer life of the pastor. So some of you may say you're stretching the taffy. You keep on pulling the same taffy. Yes, I am, because I want us to be a praying church in accordance with the scriptures, to worship the Lord God who will be set free. What a lesson it is that everybody, from the priest back then to all of the congregation, worshiping God and praying, and look what God is doing here. Jesus said, again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. Matthew 18:19. And then in 1 Chronicles 16:11, we're told, seek the Lord in his strength. Seek his face continually. And then in Psalm 91, verse 15, he shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. I want to tell you something. God is bound to bless and highly favor anyone who comes and worships him, who lives their lives rightly according to his word, who prays according to his word, and who leads others to do the same thing. God favored Elizabeth and Zechariah in five ways. And next week, if the Lord so wills, we're going to get together and see what those five ways are. I hope that you'll come back. But in the meantime, how could you be faithful to the call that God has put on your life? Worship him. Worship him. Celebrate him. His supreme worth in such a manner that his worthiness becomes the norm and the inspiration of our everyday lives. Worship him and be faithful to the call that God has put on your lives. Let's stand and sing together. And as Jim is coming, I did forget to mention, there will not be a study tonight. Patty and I have been doing so much this past week that every night has been literally booked up. And so we have not had time as a family to get together and celebrate my birthday. So we are all going out as a family tonight. So that's what we're going to do. Well, thank you very much. And so, yeah. So thank you so much. And we will pick up again. I will see you, good Lord willing, Wednesday night, if not beforehand. All right, let's sing together.
Gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer. There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love. I hold. every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for he has said that he will bring me home, and day by day I know
laid on my heart as we were singing. There was a moment in that sermon that can be a hard moment, perhaps for a lady to hear. Perhaps there is somebody right here in this own congregation that you did have an abortion somewhere in your life, and you have an overwhelming amount of guilt. I want to tell you something. There is nothing that God will not pardon. And so, if you are struck somehow by that, and you've been dealing with that, or for both men and women, you're dealing with something, that the Word of God hits you in such a way, the songs of God hit you in such a way, then don't leave here today broken, made whole in Jesus Christ. That's the grace of Jesus Christ. You just come to Him. You come to Him. It is not by works. You can't do anything. That's why he offered himself freely on the cross. That's why he died for our sins, no matter what they are. He was punished for them so that we would not be. And all he calls us to do is to turn away from whatever has broken our fellowship with him and to turn to him. The Bible says that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and he is just. And he will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And he removes all of the guilt. He removes all of the shame that goes along with it, regardless of what it is. It might be something, as I mentioned a few moments ago. It may be something else. And it may be something you're dealing with right now that you need to be set free from. I'm telling you, the Bible says, if the Son of Man shall set you free, you shall be free indeed. So my prayer and my petition to you is this. I'm going to walk down this aisle in a benediction, but I'm not walking out of this building. If you have something that you need to talk with me about, listen, you come and we'll pray and we'll seek Christ together to his glory and for your sake, that you could be freed from whatever you're carrying today. How's that happen? To him who is able to do exceedingly above all that we could ask or even think. How? According to the power that works within us, be glory in the church and Christ Jesus through all generations. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.